Good afternoon. I'm David Bahari. I teach English composition here. And I want to share with you a method of saving time when you enter comments on a student paper. Oftentimes, we end up making the same comments over and over to many students year after year, and there is a shortcut to make this process more efficient. And Word's feature called autocorrect is a very handy way to do that. Autocorrect, as designed by Microsoft, and it works for PowerPoint and Excel and so forth, but primarily with Word. The primary purpose of autocorrect is to fix typos. And it's got maybe 100 or 200 common typos pre-programmed into the system so that if you type T-E-A-H, it will recognize that as the word the and immediately change it to the. That's the designed purpose of autocorrect. However, in addition to that, you can create your own shortcuts that would look like, they're not words, they would look like a typo, and Word will then replace that typo with text that you've pre-programmed for it to use in that context. So you can create shortcuts to comments that you would use over and over again. The major advantage of this is that you can save keystrokes. If I run across a run-on sentence in a student essay, which is a common occurrence, on my system, I type R-U-N-N-N, and Word will automatically insert a 30-word explanation of what a run-on sentence is. And I've just typed in those five-letter characters, which takes seconds, and instead of many seconds, to type the comment. And the comment may be different at different times, depending on how I want to say it, but at least if I have it pre-programmed, the best way to say it, it'll come out that way every time with a shortcut. In a similar situation, I can type comma C, and I pre-programmed autocorrect to insert comma with a coordinating conjunction, connects to independent clauses, and so forth. I've typed a two-character shortcut, and Word has inserted a 31-word explanation of that situation. How do you do it? You can set up the quick access to, there's a couple steps. You set up a quick access toolbar to show so that you can insert the icon into the quick access toolbar. You notice this is from my personal computer. I have a bunch of icons set up in that quick access toolbar to make it convenient for me. These are commands that I use frequently, and I don't have to open the ribbon. To me, the ribbon is a lot of wasted space, tool space that I don't use all the time. I'd rather have workspace and a much smaller tool space, which is this quick access toolbar. Now, to insert the autocorrect icon up there, we open up the customize button that opens up this screen, and we want to add more commands. In this first field, we want to look at all the commands because it's autocorrect is not one of the popular commands. So you look in all the commands, and you scroll down through the various commands until you come to the autocorrect option with the icon. You select that. Then you hit the Add button, and it adds it over to the active field of the icons that will appear in your quick access toolbar. And then at the bottom there, you click OK, and as soon as you do that, this icon will then appear in the quick access toolbar. Now, if you're typing along and you just typed something and you say, gee, I've typed that 100 times for various students, I ought to be able to set up a shortcut to do it quicker. In this case, maybe I typed my explanation of the comma coordinating conjunction. I've selected that text. Now, after selecting that text, I hit the new icon that we just installed, and the autocorrect window opens up. Whatever I have selected will then appear in my replacement text. I then enter a shortcut, in this case, comma C, and click Add and OK, and that's done. The shortcut is then added to Word. It's also added and made available to PowerPoint and OneNote and Excel all at the same time. It's much easier to work in Word because the autocorrect menu works better in Word. You can replace text and so forth, whereas in some of PowerPoint, you're a little bit more limited in your options of what you can do with the autocorrect programming. Okay, so I'm reading along a student paper, electronically paper, and I find a place where I need a comma for this coordinating conjunction. So I type in comma C, back space bar, and Word immediately puts in the text that I just programmed it to use for that shortcut. In this case, as shown on the screen, the comments appear in underlined red font because I was working in track changes. There's some issues with track changes going from 2010 to 2013, which I'll mention in a few moments. But I find it useful, and I still use track changes. You don't have to use track changes. Whatever font your text is in where you insert the text is what your inserted text will look like otherwise if you're not using track changes. And there's ways to play with that to make it more visible for the reader, the student. One way to make it more visible to the student is to use all capital letters. I had an instructor at grad school that did that. It was very workable and convenient. Whenever I see capital letters, I know that was the instructor's comment. I have also added a double tilde for all of my comments so that it's easy to spot. I don't particularly like to use capitals, all caps myself. I use regular text, but I set off all my comments with this double tilde. As I mentioned earlier, track changes will make your text visible to the students in the underlying text. However, in Word 2013, the default setting for track changes is simple markup, whereas before it was the equivalent of all markup. So if the default setting in 2013, the student opens my commented paper and looks at it, they don't see the colored text. They see black text. And so I have to tell them specifically how to change the setting in track changes, which I'll show you how to do in a moment. Another option is if you put all of your comments within a marker, like I used a double tilde thing, you can use a search and replace and change the look of all your comments that appear within your identifiers, a double tilde or brackets or whatever you want to use. These are a few general tips on this autocorrect feature. You should use shortcuts that you would not ordinarily use in any other way. Otherwise, your program text will appear suddenly out of nowhere if you're using a common keystroke pattern. You can remove it with Control Z, but it's better to choose characters, series of characters that won't be misused, won't be used in any other way. There's also a limitation in size for this autocorrect feature. You're limited to 255 characters, and you are limited to plain text only. That means no graphics, no tables, no images, no special coloring of text or anything like that. There is a feature of Word called auto text, which is different from autocorrect. In auto text, you can insert tons of text, tons of graphics or whatever that you've pre-programmed into it. It's a little more complicated than autocorrect. It's more powerful. But for simple comments that you're inserting in a paper like these I've been showing you, the autocorrect works fine. And I'm just saying it's within those limits that you're working with. And as I said earlier, it's best created within Word because you have complete control of autocorrect, whereas in PowerPoint and OneNote, you don't have the ability to replace an existing autocorrect code. There's and possibly a couple other limitations. So primarily you're working in Word. But like I say, you can use it in other programs, including Excel. And over and beyond commenting on student papers, which you can do in Excel too, I guess, in Excel, you are often in the position where you insert complex formulas into cells. You can create an autocorrect shortcut to that formula, and you enter a couple keystrokes, and the formula appears wherever you're at in Excel, and you may have to change the parameters for the rows and columns and so forth, but it could save you a lot of time. Now, the next two slides are some examples that I use personally. I have a Word document that looks something like this. I have them alphabetized. So I have a record of all the shortcuts I've created. And if I haven't used a shortcut for a month or two, maybe I go to this Word document and look up what the shortcut is for that particular comment that I want to make. And I threw these in the slide here so that if anybody wants an idea of what they could do, here is what you would do. Even from the PowerPoint, you can select that text, hit the icon, put in your shortcut, click OK, and you've got it in your system on that computer. It's for that computer only. When I come to work in the adjunct faculty office, I don't have my shortcuts there. Sometimes I bring in my cheat sheet of all my shortcuts, and I just copy and paste it in. But if you're typically on your own machine, they'll stay there as long as that machine is there. This one called LQM. Typically, a lot of my students just put in a long quote from a text they're reading and commenting on. And it's four lines or more. And it should be, but per MLA formatting, it should be indented. You don't need the quotation marks and that sort of thing. So I just type in LQM, and this whole comment is inserted in that place. Another one that I use a lot is italics and quotes. Titles of books and plays go into italic font. Titles of poems, short stories, articles, and so forth typically go into quotation marks. Sometimes students get that confused. So I just type these few characters to insert that explanation of what's going on. Okay, I'll talk a little bit about track changes. You don't have to use track changes if you use all capital letters or you got a special marker or that sort of thing. That could work fine too. But I like track changes myself. It was designed for group editing, group writing, so people can see each other's comments before they decide on which changes to accept or reject. You can even use it for yourself. If you want to make a tentative change to your own document and you want to think about it some more, you can make that change and track changes and come back at and review whether you want to do that or not. Control-Shift-E is the shortcut for track changes. But I use it as to highlight my instructor comments. Now, as I said earlier, there's an issue with 2013 Word. This is the ribbon in 2013. You would open up the Review tab under Track Changes. And you have several options on which mode of track changes you're in. I believe the default is simple markup. And if the student has simple markup in the default state, they will see my track changes, but they will see it in black text, and it will not stand out. But if they set the show all markup, they'll see it in colored underlined font, which is more convenient. So I have a banner. I put a banner on the top of my Blackboard page when I'm returning my first set of papers. That's basically this explanation, this graphic of how to make that setting. And I also explained to them in class how to change that setting. So I think most students are getting it, how to use 2013 track changes, I hope. Otherwise, they see my comments in black text. Okay, another option here for making this text more visible is the search and replace function. If all of your comments are within special markers, say a double tilde, you can do a Control H, search and replace, to find all those instances and change them all at once in some way to make them more visible. So I Control H, open, refine, and replace. This, what appears as less here is initially more, and you hit more and you see these other options that open up that you need for this function. You have to select use wildcards under the search options because you're going to be using a wildcard up here. So in the find what, I have the intro marker and the conclusion marker, and I put an asterisk in the center of that. Because I've checked use wildcards, Word interprets this asterisk as a wildcard instead of just a plain asterisk. Okay. Then I move my cursor to the replace with field. The cursor has to be there. And then I come down here and select format. And one of the options is font. I choose font color. I could choose font size, a different font, whatever. I typically change the color of the font. And then I click replace all. And Word will go through and change every bit of text that's within those identifying markers into the color red. And I save the file. And no matter how they open up the file at that point with that track changes issue, they'll see it in red text. So that's another way to do that. If I'm in Word, and I type in some random text, I like this random text function. Okay. And it inserts text automatically. There's some Word tricks to do that. So I have some text here and I add a comment. Maybe that's the comment I want to add. So I don't have my autocorrect yet in the top level. So I come up here, select my customized quick access toolbar, click more commands. I select all commands, I scroll down to autocorrect with the icon, select it, hit add, moves it over to this side, I say okay. And back in Word, that icon has now appeared in the quick access toolbar. So now that I've got text selected, I can just click on that icon and open up my autocorrect window and type in a shortcut for that text. It has already inserted the text into the replacement text field because something is selected. If nothing were selected, I would then have to enter that text into that program field. Okay, so I put in two commas, I hit add, okay. Now I'm down here and I type in two commas. and a space bar. Wait a second. I hit a period. Hit two commas and it immediately puts it in. And that's the savings. That's the real advantage of this whole thing is I entered two characters and that many characters were entered automatically. Okay, any questions?
I just have a question about using all caps. Have you found students have a negative reaction to using all caps?
I haven't used it, so I'm not sure how they respond. I do know that I didn't like it. I encountered it in grad school. One of my instructors did that for me. I didn't particularly like it. But it saves the whole autocorrect issue if you do something like that. The other issue, though, is sometimes I might put in a comma, just put in a comma, or I might type in the word comma, or I might type in, put in my shortcut and get one of those longer explanations of what that comma is doing there. If I just put in a comma, they would never see it if it's not colored. Also, when track changes is on, you get a little sidebar on the side of the text to indicate that some sort of change was made there, which helps as well.
Yeah, I like the other options better just because I try to discourage my students from using all caps. So if I'm using it, and it defeats the purpose of trying to convince them not to use it.
Right, but it also stands out, so
sure.
That's the other side of it.
But color stands out nicely and it doesn't have the connotation of someone shouting at you.
Right. Right, I like it for that reason. And I like track changes because it goes to color automatically. You don't have to do that control search and replace thing at the end.
Just want to say this is a wonderful tool and a great time saver for reading, especially for comments that keep coming up.
It keeps me consistent too. And I can add comments as well. I mean, on the title info, lots of students don't even use titles sometimes, or they just have something really simple and general that gives the reader no clue. So that one, that entry I have for title info explains to them why it's kind of important to be informative in the title. Often at the end of that comment, I'll put a semicolon, for example, comma, and I will retitle their paper based on my interpretation of what they said, just to show them what an informative title would look like. But my explanation part is consistent. I don't have to stumble through it. I don't have to make my own typos entering that text. I've already gone through it a couple times, and I'm happy with the comments that I have and feel good about using them over and over. Now, sometimes I do have to modify them, which is easier to do if I've got the text already there, sort of thing.
This reminds me of my master's course. One of my instructors teaching APA formatting initially would be, he would take the time initially to kind of go through it, but I think he must have been getting frustrated over time saying the same thing over. It didn't take long because it's, you're making a lot of the same mistakes. But I could see where this not only is a time saver, but maybe for the instructor, I think maybe somewhat less frustrating than having to repeat the same things over and over and over.
Right.
And I also see this as a tool where you can do more comments than you normally would comment because you can give them the
It's so easy to do.
Exactly. Give them the correction and then also an example or another illustration or a reference to their textbook or something like that.
I don't think the repetition hurts for the student either. If they see this explanation of a coordinating conjunction 6 times in their paper, they know that it's an issue for them and they need to deal with it.
Sure. And you could also have a second comment, like if this is the second time you've commented on this, then
right.
By the way, take a look above.
Right. Sometimes I do typically have a comment, my own comment section that I add at the very end. First name, good job with this, that, and the other thing, but you need to handle your quotes better, or whatever my comment is, I'll put that at the end, in addition to these automated comments. So it's not just the automated comments that I use. In fact, there's a couple autocorrect shortcuts I use within my general comments, such as that topsy-down, I call it, where academic and professional writers prefer a top-down presentation where you give the main idea first and then the details sort of thing. Because I end up making that comment over and over again in the general comments section at the end.
But even your general comment section at the end could be common comments as well.
Sometimes. Yes. I am limited to the 255 characters. And there have been times when I had to watch my wordiness in order to make it within that 255.
But after that, the student's probably not reading anyway, so it's probably...
Right. Another thing I didn't mention as we went through is that the purpose here is not to fix it so they can accept the change and move on. The purpose is to explain, suggest, so that they understand the issue.
Excellent distinction, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.